for all of you to go back and see these again, you know, at any time. You can always just dip into them. So this is a demonstration on contour line drawing. So what I'm going to do is just turn my camera down on my piece of paper here and just light the room a bit. So contour line drawing is about looking at edges of things and drawing them as you see them. And so I'm just going to pull out a very simple object here, like a pair of scissors. Let's see, you know, a hand is also something that we'll be doing today too, but there are objects that really lend themselves very well for contour line drawing. And what this is about not drawing something realistically. The goal isn't to draw it perfectly and realistically. That's why it's such a non-threatening kind of an exercise. What it is for is to increase your ability to see. Like, we always look at something, but do we really see it when we're looking at it? That's the big question. So with a pen in hand, and I'm going to ask you to use a pen or a line marker, marker of some sort where you can't erase it. So this is about drawing without erasures. It's about drawing with a single line. We are going to explore our object. So let me talk you through this and how you might approach this. Let me change this trajectory of the camera a bit. There we go. Okay. So in contour line drawing, and I'm going to actually talk about one variation of contour line drawing, which is blind contour line drawing, you are not looking at the piece of paper. Instead, your eyes are focused on your object. So for the blind contour line drawing, believe it or not, I'm going to ask you to turn yourselves away from the piece of paper. And I'm doing this as I'm talking to you. And I'm going to start at any point at all on my scissors. And I'm going to draw my line, again, without looking, but very much engaged in drawing what I see. So, and not lifting my pen. When I see that I have to get from place A to place B, I simply drag my pen or pencil and continue. And it's not just about the outline, although it looks like that's what I'm doing right now, because you know the scissors blade doesn't have a lot of things going on. It's a pretty straightforward thing. But then when I get into this other place where I have the mechanism that keeps the two blades together, and I even have my thumb holding it, I'm even going to draw my thumb here. And I am just engaged in drawing the lines that I see. And that can be where two colors come together. It could be where two, literally a line dividing my skin from my nail comes together. But it is any way that you would consider calling it a line. So, all right, there's my thumb, and now I'm getting back into the scissors. And I'm gonna keep going. And again, there's not a lot of information in the handle here, but I do see that it goes inside. So I'm coming around again, and I'm drawing this. So it's really hard to talk and draw this way, because what happens is, you know, your brain really changes as you're doing this. You are focused on what you're seeing. So what happens is, and I imagine this is what you're noticing, and I can't see it. I'm just drawing along here. I am super engaged in seeing. Like, oh, there's a little piece of paint here on the side. I'm going to get that. It goes up and, gee, how far does it go up? You almost have to gauge how long does your line have to be because you can't see it. But again, it's not about drawing what you think it looks like, because I think that drawing would look a lot different. It's about what you see. So anyway, that's my that is my contour line. I love the blind contours. This line is what we're going for. This is an engaged line that shows me that I am not trying to finesse. I am not trying to draw what I think is there. I am really drawing the way my eye takes in this object. If I were to draw over here, a contour line drawing where I am actually glancing at the object and my piece of paper, might look a little bit more coordinated in that I would be able to see where these things, you know, could actually be a little bit more in line. But really, for my purposes, this is it. This is where the looking happens. And when you look at something as if for the very first time, you gain so much in terms of information and learning to slow down, which is so important. We don't do that in our culture. We don't slow down. This is why this is drawing meditation. I find that it's so valuable because you can't really draw something accurately unless you really slow down and look at it and see it. So I love contour line, and I especially love blind contour, because as soon as I tell my students, okay, you can go peek, we end up with people starting to judge what they've done. So I want us to try first some blind contour line drawing, and I'm going to walk you through this so that we do slow down. I'm going to time you. I'm going to walk you and talk you through this whole exercise. So right now, grab a pencil or a pen or even a marker. I like markers because you get a nice black line, but something that you're not going to be afraid to, that you can't erase. You know, this is the whole thing about this is you can't make a tentative line. It's got to be a line that you commit yourself to. So go ahead and find that. Grab a bunch of sheet of paper, even if it's just printer paper, it doesn't matter. This isn't anything fancy. It doesn't have to be done in good paper. Just something that you're going to be really free to go through a lot of pieces of paper. So go ahead and grab that. And also grab an object from the kitchen that has a lot of stuff going on, like a corkscrew or a just something that's got a lot of, you know, measuring spoons or even a bunch of keys, and just grab them real quickly and come back and we'll continue. So go ahead and get what you need and then come back. And when you're ready, it shouldn't be something too simple. It can't be like a cup. It really needs to be something that has lots of stuff going on in it.
Can it be like a mug with an image on it?
Mm-mm.
No,
because it's too, that isn't enough, Laurel. It has to be something with a lot of edges. We want something that's complex.
How about a pair of reading glasses?
That's not bad.
Okay.
Keys are even better. Something that's got a lot of stuff going on, because then we get into all the looking that has to be done with that. Uh-huh. All right. We're waiting for Connie and Tally to come back, and then we'll get started. So don't start yet. Let's wait for Connie, and then we're all going to work together. Great, Connie. Perfect. Oh, yeah. You've got egg beater. That's wonderful. Yeah. All righty. So, everybody, what I'd like you to do is to get yourself prepared and turn away from your piece of paper so that you're not even tempted to look. And just hold your object in your hand. Okay, so everybody, turn around. So when I look at you, I literally don't see you looking at your piece of paper. This is very important because it puts you in a different mindset. Like we were talking about, mindsets are so important. So this is not about drawing accurately. This is about seeing. Okay, so everybody's ready. All right, so put your pen down to paper, any place at all, and focusing on your object, slowly begin to draw. So this searching quality that I had in my line is what I'm looking for in yours. So it's not quickly done, it's slow, it's engaged. You're like a little ant walking along the edge of your object, taking it all in, drawing slowly. drawing, you know, when you come upon the next place in your line, you just simply draw a line to get from place A to place B. You don't break it. Keep the line going, because that will keep that slow, careful looking going. It's not about what you think you see. It's about what you actually see. All the places where there is a line coming together. As I said, it could be a difference between light and dark. It could be where a shadow comes into it. It could be a literally. So it's not about drawing this right. Slow down. It's drawing as meditation. It's looking at edges. And it's seeing as if for the very first time. So keep drawing. Resist the temptation to peek. I'm going to ask you to keep drawing until I say stop. If that means that you feel like you're done, which I doubt it, just go back to another spot on your object and continue to draw it in more and more detail. So keep going. We're going to keep going until another minute is gone before you can stop. And you're going to breathe slowly and you're going to relax into it. Just knowing that what you're drawing is the right thing. That right only means you're staying continually looking at your object. And now stop. And now take a look.
Well,
all right, everybody. Let's see what these look like. Could you just hold it up, or prep if you have a very good. No, this is great. It looks like we're really excellent. This is wonderful, everybody. All right. And by wonderful, what I'm looking for is that searching, careful quality. The not, what's the word that I want to look at? It's not glib. That's great. All right, we're going to do another one of these. Again, turn away from your page. Turn away so that you're not tempted to look. And now you're going to just relax your hand. So if you're a righty, you're going to draw your left. If you're a lefty, draw your right. Just make your hand nice and loose, and have your hands, if you're doing your hand, have your fingers kind of overlap so that you're not just drawing your outstretched hand, because that's almost too easy and we get into glibness there. But slowing down so you have lots of complexity to draw. Okay, and start. So again,
do we use our opposite hand to
draw? No. You're just drawing your hand. You know, if you're righty, keep drawing with your right hand. This is one where you're just drawing, but again, you're avoiding looking. So the whole time here, you are going up slowly, like a little crawling ant along the outside edges and the inside edges. So it's not just an outline drawing. It's slowly getting into all the nooks and crannies for every little area that you come across on your drawing, on your hand, which is so complex and so full of so much life experience. And so we're going to draw all that life experience in there. Where you see creases, where you see your fingernails meeting the skin, slow and careful drawing, very, very meditative. It's possible to spend an hour drawing on this hand, but we're going to not take quite that long. But slow, careful drawing, as if you've never looked before at your hand. Slowly breathing, slowly experiencing what you see. You're going to keep drawing until I say stop. You're going to keep drawing even though you think you may be finished. Go back to some place that you really realize, oh, you missed a whole lot there. not just the outline, but everything that you come upon. This is looking that will feed you. It's looking that expands you. And stop. And again, take a look at what you've done. It should be surprising. It should make you giggle because it's not going to be. Yeah, and how wonderful that it isn't. How wonderful that it is this journey that you were just on, exploring something as if you've never seen it before. This is the key to learning to draw, though this is not a class about learning to draw, but it's also a great exercise as to incorporate into your art practice, because when we see, when we look carefully, we expand ourselves and we slow down. And all of those things are important. Yes. Okay. Now what we're going to do is another one in which I'm going to ask you to take off your shoe and put your shoe up on your table. Shoes are wonderful because shoes are full of amazing, or take another shoe that you're not, whatever, you know, shoe you're wearing, shoe that you got around, whatever, it doesn't really matter, but put it up on your table. As you can see, they make wonderful contour line subjects because they're so complex. That's what our brain actually loves, the complexity, you know. And without looking at your piece of paper, what happens is that the part of the brain that wants to judge is silenced. You know, it can't tell you that it isn't right because it doesn't have anything to compare it to. So this is why this is such an important exercise. It frees our judge, it gets our judge away, and it also enables us to see as if for the first time. Okay, so now what we're going to do is take a little bit of a challenge and draw another contour line drawing, but only glance at your paper. So that you can kind of go back to, you know, keeping things a little bit in order, but the whole time is really spent seeing that object as if for the first time. So go ahead, put it up in front of you, your shoe. Okay, and then go ahead and start. And this time, take the whole piece of paper. If you're drawing large like I am on an entire sheet of paper, go big so that you're pushing to cover that piece of paper with the long line and the complexity, so that when you're drawing the complex parts, you have room to get into the complexity. All right, so go ahead and get started now. And glancing, we still keep the paper going. We still keep that pen drawing slowly and carefully.
So we can look periodically.
Periodically. Side. If you feel better about doing it without looking, go for it. Keep not look. For my purposes, I feel that you should just, you know, not even look at the page still. But if you want to glance, I will allow you to glance. If you promise me that you're going to not be glib and not draw what you think it should look like. Keep going back to the slow little ant crawling along the edges of things. The inner and the outer. The complexity as opposed to the simplicity. Slow and careful. Keep that judge from saying anything. Stay focused, breathe deeply. Again, this is not about doing a good drawing or an accurate drawing. It's impossible to be accurate if you can't lift your pen from the paper. So important to keep that pen going. We'll do one more minute, slowly, carefully, exploring seeing as if for the first time. Okay. And you can glance and see. Let's see how these came out, everybody. Let's see if we're still able to keep our conviction that what it looks like is not important. Okay, I think we may be still missing some of the complexity. It's all right. Let's go back. Let's do this again. We're going to take your shoe and place it in a different position. So you're seeing it upside down. You're seeing it on its side. You're seeing it turn the other direction. Okay, and now instead of using the hand that you're used to using, draw with your non-dominant hand. Right?
So if you're draw with your toes.
Draw with your toe, drawing with your nose, and draw large. So a lot of those shoes are pretty small. I want to see them as big as you possibly can. Get into the details. Do not lift your pencil or your pen. It's one long piece of yarn that you are unraveling. Slow down. Breathe. Glance, but don't draw what you don't see. Only draw what you see it as you are looking at it. So it's a journey along the outer edge, along the inner edge, texture, holes for the thread if you have something that's like a sneaker, or the place where there's a lot of texture on the sole, all of that. Slow down, drawing what you see, not what you think you see. It's not about accuracy. This is exercising our minds and our brains to slow down. You don't care what the judge thinks. Judge is out of the room. You're playfully exploring the edges of this strange new object. Okay, now stop and take a look. All right, let's see what these look like, everybody. Oh, much better. All right, good, you guys, very good. What I'm seeing is great. The no glib lines, that searching line that's so important for us.
I love the way they look. I mean, when they're not glib, like, you know, they really are interesting.
They are. I think that, you know, without saying you know, too much about it, that, you know, I prefer a lot of times seeing these contour line drawings to see an accurate, boring, you know, perfectly well drawn shoe, because who cares? These have an expressivity of line that is super important. There's a phrase, line quality, that artists sometimes use when they're describing their work or the work of somebody else, you know, and that is a line that has a certain uniqueness to it. It has a depth to it that may be a line, you know, made certainly by a computer, or a line, you know, that is, you know, super accurate, or even a sketch line. This is what I love about this kind of line, is that you don't get that tentative quality that sometimes you get from people when they're sketching. That, you know, what we're looking for is a commitment. And these lines drawings have a commitment that you all, you know, carry through very, very well when you draw this way. All right, now we're gonna do one more when I'm gonna guide you. So turn your page. Okay, And now, again, with your opposite hand, I want you to do a line drawing of your dominant hand. So you're doing again with a line that you can't control really well. Okay, that's your opposite hand drawing. You're gonna look at your hand, right? Take another position where you've, you know, got maybe a finger overlapped. And let's do one more of these with your opposite hand. You can glance, but again, more careful, more about looking and drawing what you see. So let's go ahead and do this. And this drawing should also be super large so that you're pushing right off the page. So get those lines to go right off the page. So that's how big you should feel like you're drawing. So that part of your drawing does feel like it needs to be right off the page. Okay, so let's go ahead and take that. Nice, slow, careful, with your eyes mostly on your hand. Drawing with your opposite hand. All those nooks and crannies, all those, if you're wearing jewelry, that's part of it. Everything that you see in drawing your hand is what we are trying to get to. A careful, conscious, non-glib line that searches for drawing what you really see, not what you think you see, but what you really, really see. Slow, deep breath. You're losing yourself in a process of seeing. One more minute. Slowly, carefully, big, big lines that capture everything that you see. Very good. All right, stop and take a look at this one. Yeah, and let's see, everybody. Let's see if we got so, so big that it went right off the page. Excellent. Excellent, everybody. Yes, and by that word excellent, what I'm saying is the glibness is not there. And that is what we want to go for. Such an important exercise. Now I know you know now, Laurel and Susan, this is a gift I'm giving to you that will really sustain you. And it's you know, also a great way to get into your studio practice. If you've been away from something for a while, for Laurel, whose love is flowers, take a flower, stick it in front of you, and draw right. That flower in all these many ways without looking at the piece of paper.
Yeah, this will be fun.
It is fun, it's engaging, mm-hmm. and it puts you into that flow that is, you know, getting you away from the day-to-day, you know, takes you into the space of really an appreciation for living life, if nothing else. Mm-hmm. What I want us to do now is to go ahead and get some black paint and a few brushes,
okay,
if you will. Does everybody have pretty much access to that? Yeah, get a few brushes of some different sizes and shapes and come on back with a stack of paper. Again, it doesn't have to be fancy paper. It can be printer paper, I mean. Nothing big deal, but if you have drawing paper, that's also fine. So go ahead and get yourselves ready and meet you back here in about 2 minutes with a few things.
Black paint and a few brushes is what you said. Yeah,
a little black paint, yeah. We're gonna water down that paint so that it's flowing. Yeah, so you know, something like the consistency of ink. So a little bit of water if you're using acrylics, a little bit of water, a little cup with some paint in it and some water mixed in. Got everything ready to go here? Great. Okay, so in terms of the consistency of your paint, and I'm gonna do another little demo too, just to show you. You want to have paint so that it is not too thick so that you can, move it with your brush really easily. So for me, like I'm gonna just pour some of this acrylic paint in the bottom here, just add a little bit of water to it. I don't wanna have it too thin because I don't want it to be super light. I want it to be nice and black, but on the other hand, I also want it to be easily movable, and I just poured my paint into something that already had a color in it. So let me just go back here for quickly here. Do this again. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to paint using our contour line process, which is a wonderful loosening exercise that in the same way that drawing, with a pen or a marker does. This also helps us to explore line as well as explore our ability to really see. So again, I'm gonna just focus on my piece of paper and show you what this can look like with brushes. So I feel that a lot of people use brushes without really taking advantage of what brushes can do. And, just to get the paint on there somehow. But brushes themselves can be so expressive. And I think we forget about this. But of course, it depends on the kind of painting we're doing. But if I've got a brush and I'm holding it in my fingers very, very lightly, I'm not gripping it with a death grip. I'm kind of holding it at the very, very tip and allowing gravity to move it across the page. You can see that the variety of marks I make are astounding. I can also decide to push really hard on it and give it, this blast of, full bore, or I can hold it really, really lightly and get, some really lovely, thin, delicate lines here. And I can take a different kind of brush and get a very different look to it. Here's a really thin, teeny one. I mean, it's amazing how long you can last without needing to get into refuel. But again, if you just let your brush be held with the tiny, slightest bit of a grip, you really can get extraordinary things out of it. Expressivity is what we're about here, in the same way that holding, using a marker and pushing harder or holding, getting lighter on it, also can express. So for the next minute, I'm gonna take a sheet of paper and play with a couple of these brushes you've got, just holding it from the very, very tips, allowing gravity to move it. So what you're doing here is not drawing with your wrist or your fingers. You're gonna allow a lot of it to be done by your shoulder, but your shoulder is gonna drag your brush rather than your death grip, drawing it along the edges. So go ahead and do that for a little bit and just experiment.
This time we can look, right?
Yeah, right now we're just playing, kind of getting used to using a brush in this maybe new way, maybe not new way, I don't know. Each one of you has different, experiences with brushes. But it is great to kind of, and even if you don't end up using your brushes this way, which is fine, it just allows you to think more about how you can use these. Who's coming in? Let's see. Oh, Laurel, your iPad is coming in. Okay. All right. Hi, Laurel. Sorry. So we're just, did you miss, what did you see? Did you see me do this demonstration, Laurel?
No, I didn't.
Oh, sorry. I'm so sorry. I didn't realize you weren't there. So this is about, getting your brush full of your paint and then, allowing gravity really to help you draw so that you're holding your brush way, way, way at the tip up here. You're holding it with hardly gripping it, but allowing gravity to move it across your page and experience what it's like to push really heavily on your brush, but then hold up, get a little bit lighter on it by hardly pushing it on the surface, but allow yourself to see all the different marks. Spinning your brush is another really cool thing you can do with it. Spin it and draw with it as you're painting, so that you're getting a very expressive mark from your paintbrush. So we're just doing this for about a minute or so. And then we're gonna get into some contour line drawings. Oh, I'm really liking this paintbrush when I'm got it all kind of twisty turny. It's amazing, even a really messed up brush like this one will give you lots of really interesting lines that you can make. So let's just play without trying to draw anything. We're just playing, and we should end up with a really beautiful piece of paper like the one I've just done with just many, many strange marks that you would never believe could come from a brush. And again, it's slow and careful. It's not fast, it's not glib. It's considered, it's thoughtful, it's explorative. So we don't have much use for glibness in art making. I don't have much use for it. To me, it's boring. I'm looking for the searching line. I'm looking for the line that has expression in it. And these are some of the ways that you can get your brush to be expressive. Okay, so we're gonna turn the page now, all right? Or just a new sheet of paper, whatever. And again, this doesn't have to be, a fancy piece of paper. But now, what I'd like to do is to go back to our humble, objects and draw contour line with a brush in the same exact way as you were doing. So for example, if I'm using a brush with my hand, I'm going to be, and being really large, just watch me for a second before we go any further. Okay, holding it way at the top and allowing, sorry, you can't see too well, allowing, this line, although it can't be quite as detailed as a contour line drawing, it still can still get into it. You can still, allow this brush to flow and express, what you are looking at. Again, as if you are a little tiny beetle walking along the edges, one continuous flowing line. It is going to be wonky. But that's because that's nature. When you can't stop and do sketches, you are not going to get accuracy, but instead you get a different kind of accuracy. You maybe get an emotional accuracy, and that's what we're doing here. Okay, so as you can see, funky. All right, let's go with your own funky ones. Go ahead and load up a brush. If you need to dip in again, that's totally fine. Just make sure that you go back to where your line left off. And let's do your hand. Let's start with your hand. Nice big drawing where you start any place. You can start with your thumbnail. You can start with your ring. You could start with your, your wrist or whatever. But go ahead and start nice and big with the whole sheet of paper in mind, covering as much as you can. Slow down. Okay, so let's go ahead. And again, continue to draw with your brush for a while until I say stop. Slow, careful looking is what we're after here.
We're looking. This time we're looking, right?
Look mostly at your hand because that's what's most important. But you know, you can glance at your paper only maybe to even to keep your brush on the paper. But the more important looking is done on your hand. Because again, this is not about accuracy. This is about emotional accuracy. This is about careful looking, careful seeing, drawing something as if you've seen it only for the very first time. The experience should be searching. It shouldn't be judging. And that's what happens when you don't look at the paper. The less you look at the paper, the less you're going to judge. It's an exercise on learning how to keep the judge out of the room. Keep drawing. Draw until I say stop. Keep it going on the page. Fuel up some more paint, only if you need more paint. Enjoying the slow, careful, meditative experience of drawing as if you've never seen this object before. Relaxing into it. It's the flow of drawing in this way that we're after. There's only you and the paintbrush. And stop. Okay, everybody, let's see what you're doing here. Again, I'm looking just to make sure that we are not getting literal. We are not getting realistic. Okay, we're gonna go back to not looking. Okay, do not look at your paper this next time. We are letting that judge in. This is not about drawing as what you see. It should be wonky. If it's not wonky, it's not working. You can quote me on that. All right, everybody. One more time. Now, put your object, you know, go back to one of the objects you were drawing. It doesn't have to be your hand. In your hand, turn your page. Turn yourself away from your paper so that you cannot look at your paper. This might be, you know, a little bit tricky because you may need to load up some more paint, you know, and that's fine if you need to do that. But let's begin again. Let's not look at our piece of paper. Let's turn our bodies, literally force yourself. You cannot look at your paper, okay? And you're having your object, maybe it's your shoe, maybe it's a pair of keys, maybe it's your sunglasses, whatever it is, you're holding it in your hand. Start any place and begin to draw. Deep breath, slowly, carefully, no glib lines. Drawing as if you've never seen this object before. Slowly and carefully. Everywhere you see a line is fair game. It could be a shadow, the edges of a shadow against another lighter area. It could be a color change. It could be an actual line. It could be stitches. It could be, you know, a shift in whatever it is that you're looking at. That's fair game for a line, but slow down. Deep breath. Relax. Drawing only what you see, not what you think you see. And stop. Okay, let's see these. Much better. Much better. Much better. Good. Okay, great. There you go. Do you see the difference? Yeah?
Wonkier.
Yeah, wonkier.
Yes, because we're not about trying to make it look real or trying to make it look like it. We're using, this is a source. It's a source material. It's a way to learn about, you know, how our eyes and our brains work. You know, it's a way to slow ourselves down, and it's a way to gather information. So without information, where do we make our art from? We have to, you know, it has to spring from somewhere. So I love using these particular things to kind of jump off of. All right, so now what I'm going to ask you to do is to take this let me see, what am I going to do here? I'm going to do this one more time. Okay, yeah. All right, take one of these drawings that you've done, one that you feel covers a lot of the page, okay? Whatever one you feel, and it could be your line drawing, it could be the painting. You're not gonna pick the one that looks more like your object. You're gonna pick the one that you think has, you know, really covering the surface and has, you know, these really interesting lines going on. In fact, you know what, never mind. What I want you to do is to take the one where you were playing with your brush. All right. Yeah. Use that one. So sorry. I'm doing this for a reason, because we're going to kind of take this and do an iteration of it. So, all right. So take the one piece that you have that you were playing with. Remember that one that's got all the lines all over it. Okay. I'm going to show you what we're going to do. Okay. All right, so here is mine. It's just all over the place, but it's interesting. There's so much here that I can work from. So what I'm gonna do is tearing it out. And just watch me before you go and do this, all right? All right, so we're gonna tear this out of the pad. I'm gonna just take off this annoying bit. There we go. And now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna cut it up. I'm gonna cut this up into a bunch of different quarters and another time. So I've got 8 pieces now. Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to rearrange now on another sheet of paper. So let me do this. Okay, so what I want to do is I'm going to just take 4 of these. Why 4? Because I want us to have some white space. So I'm going to take these 4. And I'm going to rearrange them on my piece of paper in a way that's going to force me to be innovative. It's going to make me figure out how to deal with this extra area. So what I want you to do is to go ahead and take your 4 pieces. Cut this piece up, make 8 pieces of paper out of it, and then take a clean sheet of paper and rearrange these in any way that you'd like. But here's the thing, pay attention to your edges. So you want your pieces of paper to go off the edges at least once or twice as you rearrange them. So that's just part one. We're gonna come back, okay? So everybody go get to that place. It almost doesn't matter where you place them, because you're going to see what we're going to do to them. What we're going to do in the process of doing this exercise is going to really change it. So go ahead, cut up your piece of paper.
Is it all rectangles though?
It doesn't really matter, Tally.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah, okay. You just want smaller pieces. You could rip it, you could cut it, you could make you know, circles out of it, doesn't really matter because you're going to see what we'll do with this.
Do you want us to attach the pieces to the paper?
Not yet. We'll get to that.
Did you say four pieces or doesn't it matter?
Yeah, just four pieces, which would be good because we do want to have some white space because we're going to be playing some more. So once you've got your four pieces of paper, or how are we doing there? How many people have got some kind of an arrangement? Mm-hmm. Everybody, yeah? Good. So go ahead and glue them down to this new sheet of paper. It can be, you know, any kind of glue you have lying around. I like a you know, acrylic medium. It's a good one, but anything you have is fine. And while you're doing that, I'm going to do mine. I'm going to work right along with you.
Bird.
I think that's Connie's dog. Is that?
You're my dog. Oh gosh, yes. Oh, obsessively so barking. She sounds like a goose or something.
She does. Yeah, she does. It's not my dog. My dog is so loud. Oh my god, it's just so annoying, and she insists on barking at everybody who comes in the house or passes by, and I just
yeah. I got it.
But that's her breed. She's a beagle, and she just can't help herself, and it's very annoying. Doesn't she know I'm trying to zoom here?
I know. I'm trying to come up with. Hey, car. Stop it.
Don't worry about it, Connie. It's all good.
Thank you.
Oh my goodness.
Sounds like a bird.
It does.
I know. It's a squeak. She has a squeak, Tally.
She does.
Squeak.
Oh. Okay, so how are we doing with the gluing?
Okay.
All right, just let me know when you're done. I've got one more myself to glue on here. And we'll continue. So what we're doing here is I'm taking you through some a model of what you might consider an iteration of an idea. So that's one of the things that we have to figure out what to do as we get into a studio practice is how to take it from place A to place B. Because a lot of us are used to doing one-offs, you know? I've one piece, finished it, go on to the next piece. But a lot of times what happens with that is we might change materials, we may change content completely or subject matter. You know, it's like just kind of jumping from one thing to the next without getting into this exploration, which is, you know, so much of what a studio practice is, I think it should be. And it's what, you know, as you hang your shingle out as an artist is what you long for, is what you look for, an idea or a topic or even a technique that has legs, that's going to go with you for the long term, that's going to sustain you you know, sustain you, sustain that practice, sustain your interest, sustain your enthusiasm, because if you get bored or if you run out of ideas, you're going to stop. So how do you keep that, the juices flowing? That's the big question. All right, so how are you doing on everybody all set with the gluing?
Yeah.
Okay, so now I'm going to turn back to my piece here in front of me and tell you about our next steps. So our next step is, and as you can see, I've got these random and sort of strange kinds of shapes everywhere. What I want you to do is to take your brush and connect these shapes to each other. So this is kind of funny. I'm going to look at the edges like here, and I'm going to let my brush just meander. So I'm going to take my brush for a little walk and have it just sort of join in the fun here and kind of connect these different places. And it can connect in odd ways. Like it doesn't have to all line up. It just can kind of move sort of generally over the whole thing. And I see another one that I want to connect up. So I'm going to just take it again for a walk and meander along and try to you know, go back to that mode of matching some of this, you know, interesting brush mark making that you did by spinning your brush around or, you know, pressing hard on it so that it's not always the same. So go ahead and do this for a little while. I don't, you know, want you to turn it into just a complete mass of marks, but I want you to now join these pieces of the puzzle so that when you look at this now, it does have a look of a single piece, right? So go ahead and do that then. After you're gluing, go ahead and take a brush or two brushes and just have fun rejoining some of those odd marks. So that then what you're ending up with now is a little bit of a design that has connected across over your whole sheet of paper. It's kind of fun. It's like a challenge. How do we get this whole thing lining up here? How can I, you know, make place A, place B, connect? What can I do? Okay, just a little bit longer. This should not take that long. This is, you know, again, because we don't want it to be just you know, too many black lines. We want to have some open areas for the next reason. You'll see that. Okay. And now what we're going to do is pick two colors. I'm going to show you what to do next. I'm picking two colors here. I'm very random here. I'm picking yellow and red just because they're here. And now what I'm going to do is, and see how quickly we're doing this. We're not spending a lot of time thinking about it. It's just basically grab what you have. I'm going to take those colors and I'm going to rapidly fill in some of the spaces. So these edges end up being the edges of interesting shapes that we didn't have before. So just spend a little bit of time using both the red and the yellow, or, you know, in your case, whatever two colors you happen to see first, and just paint them in. So we're using our shapes kind of conveniently as a place to paint in. All right, so go ahead and do that. We're gonna take about 10 minutes to get that pretty much done. You don't even have to fill in all of them. In fact, it might be nice to leave some of them not filled in. But just go quickly in and fill in these some of these shapes, because this is on our way to another thing. We're not done yet. And I'm going to do this with you. I have a nice idea of how long this might take. Shouldn't take long. This should be pretty quick. You work quickly, so that we don't get stuck in too much editing, too much thinking. Do it, don't think. Bypass that brain. Can be sloppy, doesn't have to be fancy. Sloppy is good. Painterly, we call it, not sloppy. Casual, relaxed, having fun. This is what, you know, this is. Let's be, I'm curious, what's gonna happen next? I'm curious. You know, you drive yourself with your curiosity rather than with fear. You know, an open mind and an open heart. Wow, what's gonna happen when I do this? Gee, I wonder what she's doing here. Wow, this is really strange. Okay, just a few more minutes. Again, we want to move through this fairly rapidly. You don't want to get stuck. one more minute. Okay, everybody. All right, let's look back at the screen again because I'm going to show you what is going to be next. Adria is really crazy now. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut this up into four. Okay, so I'm not even measuring. I'm just going to randomly cut this up into four. There are four fairly equal segments. Okay, if you lose some of the pieces in the process, that's okay. We have four new paintings here, everybody. Okay, now I've got four paintings. Now, on each of these four, you're going to take one more color and continue to work. So take another color that you haven't used yet. And on each one of these, quickly paint one more color. Okay. I'm going to do that too. And I'm leading you through this. So there is a method to my madness.
So you cut them up in rectangles, right?
Yep.
Fair enough.
And you're going to just add one more color to each one. Only where you want it. You can leave some white. Quickly, quickly. Don't think. Just do. Okay. Now, the next instruction is you're going to work on sheets of paper that are about 8 by 10. You know, this is approximately the size that a piece of printer is. Take each one of those little paintings you just did, cut them up into 4, and rearrange them on this piece of paper. Glue them down and repeat. Repeat the process. So if I have them, you know, that's too easy. I'll do one like this. It's nice to have them going right off the page if you can. You could try lining them up. You could even overlap them if you'd like. But the next step is to keep working, to keep the iteration going. So let's do that. Take one of your pieces to start with, cut it up into 4, take another sheet of paper and rearrange it. And while you're doing that, I will start to glue mine down and we'll talk about what comes next.
So each of the 4, we cut into 4.
Yes. Yes.
Gotcha. Now you've left yours with straight edges.
Yeah, but you know, again, you don't really, for this part, you don't really need to. It could really be any shape because you are just kind of using them as a place to start from. I'm just making this up as I'm going along, Tally. So, you know,
gotcha.
there's only rules in as much as, you know, this is a decision that I'm giving you. But the point here is that
What are you doing?
In any given set of possibilities, there's a way in which you can go on and on and on without end, really. And, you know, this involves kind of giving up and saying, oh, I really like that, but that's okay. I'm going to sacrifice it for the good of the cause. And I'm going to use it to get moving onto some other creative endeavor here. And that's what I'm doing. So I'm just kind of re-gluing and giving myself another challenge. So what I'm going to do here is just have you just look up here and stop, because I'm going to let you for the rest of the class, you know, for another 15 minutes or so, work on these on your own. So everybody, here's one of these new pieces that I've just made with the same thing where I've got white spaces. What I'm going to do now is continue that same sort of set of parameters that I defined for myself earlier. I'm going to take the black lines and connect them. I'm going to, you know, keep going and be sort of, again, as whimsical as I can be to make it, you know, behave better on the whole page. Going right to the edge with saying things, you know, matching up things that I think should be matched. And then continue with my painting areas. So, you know, if this breaks up, that's okay. You know, you might want to just join that line. I could repaint that a different color, but keep on with each one of these sets, keep going. So this is called iterative. You know, this is an iterative painting process where you start with something. It could be a contour line drawing of your hand. It could be just marks up as we did today that were just, you know, kind of warm up. But you start with something and you then, you know, keep moving through the stages. So it just, no part of this process is an end in itself. It all leads to iterations. It all leads someplace else. Okay, so now it's up to you now where you'd like to go with color. You could keep using the same 3 colors that you started with. You could decide to add a whole new color. You could decide to add more white. But this now is yours. So I'm going to pass the ball to you. I'm going to have you work another 15 minutes. Let's see what happens and come back to us in 15 minutes and let's look at iterations.
Adria?
Yeah.
I have a question. Okay, so you just took four of your the series that you did. Basically we have four sets of four, right?
Yeah.
So we're going to just do four on each page, right?
Yeah.
Then iterate from there. Okay.
Iterate from there. That's right.
Okay. Yeah. All right. And you could put them anywhere you want.
Anywhere you want. Being mindful that you do want a whole composition, you know, at the end of any given sort of set of uh-huh. your instructions. Yep.
Okay. Very good.
So have fun with this. I have music I can play for everybody to listen to, would anybody like me to do that? I think listening to music is great, but I know that you're in your own homes and you could easily just turn on your own thing mm-hmm. to listen to. What would you like? Anybody like me to put something on?
That would be nice. I would like that.
Put it on. And if you don't want to listen to it, you can just turn that off. But let's just do that and I will stop it at around 15 minutes. Okay, so I've got to share my screen so that you can all hear the sound. I love listening to music. I think it's a great way to get ourselves out of our own heads.
It's nice. Yeah. I'm glad you suggested that because I discovered all kinds of new things in jazz yesterday.
Great. Yeah, it's really good. I'm so glad. So let me get this. Let's see here. There you go.
Thank you.
Let's see, get some more music going here. So just a reminder, what we're trying to do is go ahead and, you know, bring to some place of conclusion all four sheets of paper with these new iterations on them, right? So you have four, 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 right? And each one has, you know, you're going to glue those down and then meet the lines and then paint in without thinking, without deciding what's good or what's bad, just doing it, okay? Okay, we'll work another 5 minutes, everybody, and then come together again. So one more little bit of time. Oops, that's too noisy. Let's see, what do we got?
Bless you. There's usually three.
Okay, everybody, you know what, we're just gonna stop here because I do wanna have a little bit of time to process this. So just put your brushes back in the water for a few minutes and we will just kind of round it up with the day. So what just happened? What was that?
Michael.
What did I make you do? Tell me.
Well, you brought me back to elementary school because in early elementary school, we had an art teacher who we did, except not with brushes and paint. We did it with crayons and colored pencils. We did the whole thing of making what she called just make squiggles and cover the whole piece of paper. And then we took colors and we colored in wherever we wanted to. And I have been doing that ever since, whenever I'm stressed or whenever I'm, you know, I'm bored or anything like that. I have a little notebook and a little sketchbook that I have all these ones like that in it. Now the cutting it up is an interesting new aspect that I'm gonna put into my boredom practice. So
yeah,
it was fun. It was a lot of fun.
Very engrossing.
Connie, did you want to say, so what happened? What are we going to process this? What did you just do?
Well, it was just very engrossing and it like completely took your mind off your troubles. It just like, you just kind of get into the groove. It felt great. I think this is so important. I like it. I like it a lot.
Good. Yeah, anybody else? Let's see, Tally or Tammy or Laurel, what are your thoughts? What did you just do? What did I just have you do?
Well, I thought it was fun.
Laurel, you're muted. Laurel's muted. Tally, thank you.
I'm not muted, am I?
No, anyway, you're not. Laurel is,
I thought it was fun. I wished I felt that I liked at least one of them, but I don't.
All right. Well, yeah. So we didn't even chat about liking or not liking, did we?
Yeah.
Yeah. Laurel, what did you think? What just happened to you?
It was very playful. It was fun. A different way of working with materials than I usually do, and had me thinking, you know, what if I approach this thing that I'm working on with these kinds of options, just cutting things up and pasting them here randomly, and you know, seeing about coming up with different combinations than I usually do. I like that.
Yes, yes. And Tally, what did you? I mean, are there Tammy? Yeah, Tally and Tammy. Yeah. Tammy. Yeah. What did you just go through there over there?
Yeah. So I'm realizing that I want to do this on my own. And instead of using paint, I'm going to do markers or something and pencil. Because I feel like part of the, like, I realize that I just don't like glue. And I don't like the whole, like, some messiness stuff I love. Like, I love being messy with paints, but like the gluing and then the cutting up and whatever. So I would rather, I think, practice with markers.
Yeah.
Just to cut that piece out. But yeah, like, I think that it was really fun today. And messy,
yeah, so you're right. Well, I mean, that's great. And I'm glad that you enjoyed it. I think what I am introducing for you here is this concept of, you know, how to delve down, you know, and instead of across, down into. And that, you know, this is just an example of a kind of way of working. It's not for everybody. And I know, you know, some of you are not, this isn't the thing that's going to, but it is a way to show you that, you know, you can discover new ways of approaching your work if you also, you know, apply sort of creativity to how you go about it. So you can set up, this is like setting up for yourself a way of working where you just naturally get deeper. And that the other, you know, the logical conclusion here is that in every set, you can go deeper and deeper and deeper. You can take every set, cut it up, rearrange it, paint into it. And, you know, and it's also a way of you know, you don't get stuck in the judge, because the sort of parameters you've set for yourself kind of set you up for success in that way. You know, you are set up so that you don't end up in a place where you're not sure. The other thing to know is that after you do get to a certain place, then you can go and edit. Then it's like, all right, well, what do I have here? What do I think about it? Does it want to be this way? Does it want to be that way? Does it, you know, do I want to use it as a background? Do I want to cut more things into it? I mean, it just gives you a way to get started. Mm-hmm. So I you know, give this to you as a possibility, and also as a way to start talking about how we can go deeper into our work. And I want to, each class from now on, kind of introduce to you another way that you can do that. And, you know, I think that it might be worthwhile for me actually to do some things, you know, within representational imagery, where we can explore, you know, how we can go further and further and further. So that's what this was all about today. You know, first to introduce this contour line drawing as a way to feed ourselves, you know, you got to put stuff in there to get things out. And that's what art dates are for too. And we didn't talk about them, but I didn't want to, you know, have you try to have an art date for yourself every week, even if it's just like a half an hour, where you're, you know, recharging the energies, feeding yourself. You know, it could be reading a book, it could be looking at art books, it could be going to a museum, it could be taking a walk in nature, whatever it is out there that, you know, feeds you, that's great. And that should be part of every week. Even every day if you can, but I'll go for once a week. But also, this contour line drawing is something, you know, you can always do. doesn't take a lot, doesn't even take a lot of time, but it's rich. It's a rich source to mine because it's a way to bring in the real world, you know, use objects, but not be sort of stuck trying to make them realistic. You know, it's not about that. As I said, it's more true about emotion than it is true in terms of what it looks like. So it's always a good one to go to. All right, everybody. Well, thank you. Thanks for bearing with me and leading you down this crazy kind of spot. I'll send you some email about, you know, what to do for next week. But presumably you are working on some thoughts. And I know that some of you actually wrote to me and thank you. I got all that and I'm really grateful to hear about it. We didn't look at Padlet even. But I think today I really did want to introduce some of these to you. So see you next week. To be continued. Have a great week, everybody.
Thank you, Andrea.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.